talks by Bill T. Jones, who we're thrilled and honored that he's here today. My name is Peter Filkins. I teach translation here at Bard College and poetry and literature over at Bard College at Simon's Rock. I am a translator of H.G. Adler's novels and currently working on a biography of him, so I'll be starting in it whole hog, if you will. Before I start, I want to make a little logistical announcement, and that is there are no restrooms in this building, so you need to use the neighboring building, the Studio Arts building, which is sort of down the slope there, and restrooms are available there. I want to first begin by thanking the Hannah Arendt Center for sponsoring this event, as well as the Bard Translation Initiative and the Human Rights Program at Bard, German Studies Program, and the Jewish Studies Program. Really deeply grateful for their support and for all their organization, and particularly for the Hannah Arendt Center and all of the organization that they have helped with. What I'm going to do is introduce some of our main panelists today, as well as our faculty who are participating in the event, and I'll tell you a tiny little bit about H.G. Adler himself before we begin. Our keynote speaker will be Jeremy Adler, who is Professor Emeritus of German Literature at King's College London. He's the editor of Der Wahrheit verpflichtet, H.G. Adler Interviews, Gedichte, Essays, and the author of Eine fast magische Anziehungskraft, Goethe's Wahlverwandtschaften und die Chemie seiner Zeit. It's about Goethe's elective affinities and how chemistry, his knowledge of chemistry, helped structure that novel. He has edited several volumes of works by his father, Hans-Günter Adler, Elias Canetti, and Franz Behrend Steiner. He has also written on the influence of Goethe on Henry James, articles on Kafka and Hölderlin, and he frequently contributes reviews and articles to the Times Literary Supplement. He has been a fellow at the Institute of Advanced Study in Berlin and is a member of the German Academy of Language and Literature. Joining him on our first panel will be Amy Lowenhaupt-Lauweis, who is the founding director of the Theresienstadt Publishing Project and is editor and co-publisher of the English language edition of H.G. Adler's Theresienstadt, 1941-1945, The Face of a Coerced Community, which will be published by Cambridge University Press in English translation this fall. She has written on Theresienstadt and the Jewish encounter with modernity for scholarly journals and nationally syndicated periodicals in the U.S. and abroad. She is the recipient of numerous grants and awards, including the Memorial Foundation for Jewish Culture grant for her forthcoming book, Songs in the Wilderness, Music in the Holocaust, and the Betrayal of Building. Joining her will be Professor Roger Berkowitz, who is Associate Professor of Political Studies and Human Rights here at Bard, and the Academic Director of the Hannah Arendt Center for Politics and the Humanities here at Bard. Then we will have a musical interlude, which will be two poems written by H.G. Adler set to music by Victor Ullmann. And that composition occurred in Theresienstadt itself. And it will be tenor Rufus Müller, who is an accomplished tenor of the world stage and associate professor of music at Bard, who also teaches in the Bard Conservatory. Joining him on piano will be Lawrence Wallach, composer, pianist, and musicologist who holds the Lipsing Hall Chair in Music at Bard College at Simon's Rock, and who also teaches at the Bard Conservatory. And then we're very pleased to have Bill T. Jones, artistic director, co-founder, and choreographer of New York Live Arts, who is a multi-talented artist, choreographer, dancer, theater director, and writer, and has received major honors, including the MacArthur Grant Genius Award and the Kennedy Center Honor in 2010. On the second panel will be translator Belinda Cooper, who is adjunct professor at Columbia University's Institute for the Study of Human Rights and New York University's Center for Global Affairs and a senior fellow at the World Policy Institute and the primary translator of the Theresienstadt book, which will appear this fall. Then myself will be on the second panel as well, and joining us to respond will be Cecile Kuznets, associate professor of Jewish history and director of Jewish studies, and Wyatt Mason, senior fellow at the Hannah Arendt Center. Finally, joining us will be H.G. Adler, Hans-Günter Adler, born in Prague in 1910, and who died in London in 1988. He was the author of 26 books of fiction, history, poetry, sociology, and religion, and he spent 32 months in Theresienstadt before going on to survive Auschwitz and two other camps. His Theresienstadt 1941 and 1945 was first published in 1955 and reissued in a second edition in classic of Holocaust scholarship, it is still in print in Germany and is due to appear in English for the first time this fall from Cambridge. His novels, Panorama, The Journey, and The Wall, have appeared in recent years in English translation, and his collected poems, Amore Vega, were recently issued in an edition of some 1,200 pages. Awarded the Leo Beck Prize and the Lubbers-Rotenzweig Medal, he was also elected to the Bayerische Akademie der Schönen Künste back in the 1950s. So we will begin our program. It's my great pleasure to introduce someone I've worked with for over 10 years on his father's work, Professor Jeremy Adler of King's College.
Setzt in der ersten Reihe. Okay. Hans-Günther Adler did not appear singled out for the fate which was to shape his life and work. He was born, as Peter said, in Prague in 1910. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Born in Prague in 1910 into the same German-speaking community that had produced Rilke and Kafka, he seemed destined to lead the life of a poet, a career for which his pre-war literary friendships with Franz Bernhard Steiner, Hermann Grab, and Elias Canetti boded well. Professionally, he planned to be an academic, specializing in literature, although he studied musicology. Nothing more clearly shows his place in the German tradition than the fact that he was in Berlin collecting material for his dissertation on Klopstock and music when he became a witness to Hitler's seizure of power in 1933. The rise of the Nazis put paid to his career, yet his plans to emigrate fell through. In August 1939, he managed to obtain a train ticket from Prague to Paris, but no visa for France, let alone an entry permit into Great Britain. And so he was trapped in Prague at the outbreak of the war. He endured a period of forced labor building a railway in 1941, as recorded in chapter 8 of his novel Panorama. And then back in Prague, later that year, he married his first wife, a doctor, Gertrude Klebetar. They were deported to Theresienstadt or Theresien together with Gertrude's parents on 8th of February 1942, where they were imprisoned for 2.5 years. As we now know occurred with others destined to survive, Adler derived strength from the need to bear witness, and specifically from the desire to represent his experiences. In an interview for a German television in 1986, he recalled, "When it came to the deportations, I told myself I won't survive. But if I do survive, I want to represent it, and in two different ways. I want to explore my experience in a scholarly manner, and so separate it from myself completely, and I want to portray it in a literary manner. I've done both, and the fact that I have done so is no great achievement, but it does provide a small justification for having survived." So the literary opus and the scholarly opus are a debt which he repays to the dead. It's a thanksgiving and a debt repaid. Transforming his experience into literature was a survival strategy. He says, "It was an act of self-liberation. I always said to myself, if I do go under, I want to go under with dignity. I want to preserve my dignity." So that was the core to his experiences, whatever he went through, the sense that he was a human being in the most terrible suffering and situations that he found himself in. He acted on this belief with perilous equanimity, which several times led him almost to the brink of the disaster from which it finally extricated him. He told the following anecdote. An SS man wanted to beat me up because I had done something awkward. And I said to him, "Could you wait a moment? I just have to take off my glasses." And the chap really waited. Of course he beat me up, but not as badly as he would have done. And that was that. Those were my personal reactions. I knew that it could destroy me, but I just behaved like that, and it gave me a lot of strength. The worst thing to be in that situation was an intellectual, and in the last and the worst camp he went to, he was asked what his profession was, and out of some instinct he said, he drew himself up to his full height and said, "I'm a doctor of philosophy." Really the worst thing to be in a camp. And they just said, "Oh, so you can use a typewriter, can you?" And he said yes, and so he survived, thanks to his ability to type. On the 12th of October 1944, he was transported to Auschwitz with his wife and mother and her mother. On the ramp, Gertrude's mother went to the bad side, and Gertrude, his wife, my father's wife, joined her mother, so that she should not go to her death alone. Adler went into the so-called gypsy camp, and after a fortnight, he was dispatched to outlying camps of Buchenwald, where he was liberated on the 13th of April 1945 by American soldiers, and I'm very pleased to say that here. The first literary transposition of these experiences occurred in over 130 poems, only a selection of which were published in his lifetime, but all of which have appeared now. About 100 were written in Theresienstadt, and the rest he wrote immediately after passing through Auschwitz. Initially, there was a sequence of poems called the Theresienstadt Picture Book, in which he depicts all the cruelties of the camp. People with tan ribs, the rotting corpse of an old woman, and so forth. The poems convey a sense of the physical image of the kind that after the liberation of Belsen in 1945, imprinted themselves on the collective imagination as the emblem of the final solution. They show the bodily torment of human beings condemned to extermination. Besides physical details, the poems evoke an all-pervasive sense of fear and a tangible, suffocating feeling of anguish. The heavy stress in the lines often choke the reader's breath off, so that you can hardly complete the poem in your reading. Clotted, suffocating diction evokes dirt, animal imagery, and physical suffering. But having written in this externalistic way, describing physical characteristics and corpses, he turned away from the externalist approach to suffering and looked within at the human soul. And from then on, really, he never took the way of the normal attitude to the Shoah of being fascinated improperly by filth, corruption, and pain, and looked at the inner person, the inner suffering, and the potential to be free in the most impertinent and degrading circumstances. And that became the line for another set of poems which he wrote in Theresienstadt, which are still to be properly understood. The turn from outer suffering to within enables him to discover the core of goodness within the sufferer and to concentrate on the individual's potential for goodness, even in the most extreme situation. The point of this really is that the externalistic approach condemns the victims to eternal suffering, to eternal slavery, and eternal subjugation. When we see these images before us, the victims are always victims. They're always suffering. They're never liberated in their souls. And he wanted to move away from that, to grasp them as valid, valuable, decent human beings. Ordinary, with mistakes, but genuine people. So, metaphysically, he frees the subject from its chains. And if he can't actually reinstate their dignity in their lives, he can at least do the best he can. It was in the camps, too, that Adler, like Eugen Kogon, the author of the first full study of the Nazi machinery, began to collect material for a scholarly representation of the genocide, which he then wrote in 1945-1948, and eventually published, as Peter Filkin said, in 1955 as Theresienstadt, 1941-1945. And I'm very pleased that Amy Lowenhaar is here tonight, who has done so much to bring the translation into being, and Belinda Cooper will also be speaking to us as the translator of that book. That makes this a very important occasion just prior to the publication of the Theresienstadt book in English. The monograph is one of the earliest attempts to create a sociology after the Holocaust, as indicated by the subtitle History, Sociology, Psychology. It's constructed like a classic ethnographic field study in the manner of Malinowski's monograph on the Trobriand Islands. Theresienstadt, 1941-1945, attempts a detailed empirical reconstruction of the camp, its history, its functioning, and its institutions, and concludes with a general analysis of Nazi ideology, interpreted as a perfidious, highly specific, yet in some ways also typical manifestation of modernity, and what Adler calls mechanical materialism. The chief evil he sees in modernity led to Nazi ideology in the camps, and it's to the treatment of people as material objects rather than civic subjects that we owe so much of the disasters that occurred in the 20th century. Red and black fascism alike transformed people into objects. Theresienstadt, the book, was a foundational work in Holocaust studies and was highly influential on the development of the discipline. It was one of the first works in what is now a regularly recognized discipline. Around this central book, a host of other publications clustered, which form a kind of Gesamtkunstwerk, and all relate to each other. There's a study of the history of the Jews in Germany, which describes the path into the catastrophe. There's the magnum opus of 1974, Administered Man, which takes up the story and treats the entire process of deportation. The intractable dilemma of Auschwitz is illuminated in a volume of eyewitness accounts. One study deals with Hitler, another portrays the resistance to the final solution. And then there are a host of major essays, some of which Peter Filkins has recently republished, such as one on Nietzsche, another one on Hitler, and a further one on the concept of the masses, which Adler subjects to a very sustained critique. Again, masses, treating people as masses, leads to a kind of commodification of the individual and a betrayal of individual human rights. It's the dignity of the individual which is core and key to his project. And in the book, The Wall, which has just come out in Peter Filkin's translation, the narrator reflects on human rights as follows. The dignity of man is guaranteed by the assignation of material and non-material values. This is a writer who asks his reader to think. Values bestowed on the individual by society. The complete attainment of this dignity corresponds to the optimum of freedom from oppression which society permits. Any person is oppressed who is denied or deprived of inner values. So we achieve our rights through the ascription of our of values to us by society. I value you, you value me, and on that basis, society works. And in our daily intercourse, we are exchanging value with each other when we shake hands, when we smile, when we nod, when we wave. All of these things are terribly important, because of course, if you wave and I make a rude gesture, the whole thing crumbles. So value is core and key for H.G. Adler. And value is precisely what regimes like the Nazis and the communists in Russia destroyed. They took away the value that could be ascribed to people, or in the same way any slave is betrayed by the removal of his value. It's a concept very close to dignity. I think I'm nearing the end of what I've got to say, and we'll draw to a close on that note. Just to point out that these notions run through the poetry, the prose, and the scholarly work. All of these are united by such concepts and reciprocally illuminate each other. So if you read one book, you will find yourself being referred to another. And the books themselves are constructed, and that's one of the things which makes them difficult reading, as referential entities constantly referring forward and back to different moments in the book. You don't get a straightforward narrative in the novels. It's cut up, there's montage. You have to move backwards and forwards in order to know everything. In other words, we're dealing here with a kind of modernism. Modernism in Theresienstadt is the attitude of the anthropologist Malinowski applied to human beings. A modernist in the literary work is someone who uses post-Joycean and post-Virginia Woolf and post-Faulkner techniques for creating a world which can be illuminated by the mind. There I would like to stop and leave you with that thought. And thank you for your patience.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
There we go. Theresienstadt, 1941-1945, is at heart an exploration of the failure of community. The Zwangsgemeinschaft, the coerced community, is, as Adler says, a community of fate. It is not to be confused with the official communities that govern relations between Jews and the various states in which they resided in the modern era. Nor is it the provisional community created in crisis of the pre-administration ghetto. In describing this failed communalism, Adler identifies with and speaks for no single group within the ghetto's variegated populations, but rather in the name of a spirit of Judaism that has been lost. Yet while he decries this loss, he does not state explicitly what this spirit is. Nowhere in the entire text does he positively define Judaism. He recognizes that a factionalized Jewry is implicated in this loss and that the legal community of the ghetto has been misconstrued by the Jewish leadership as, at one end of the spectrum, a reflection of an ossified assimilation that has, as he says, frozen into a bygone ideal, and at the other end, a form of Jewish nationalism that merely mimicked modern programs of redemption. For Adler, no known normalization of the Jews appears possible. Prefiguring Hannah Arendt, Adler details the two alternatives, as he says, that are only superficially contradictory, that the Jews are presented with in modernity as an antidote to ceaseless wandering, the termination of which has become, as he puts it, an eschatological goal. The first option is one in which the Jewish individual is absorbed and put on equal footing with other individual nationals. The second is one in which the Jewish people is put on equal footing with other nations via a final migration. The first option, however, necessitates the individual Jews relinquishing his or her uniqueness as a Jew for inclusion within a given nation state. And the second requires the Jewish people's relinquishment of its defining feature of metahistoricity in order to take its place among the secularized, temporally grounded nations. While the accommodation of the Jewish councils can be seen as a legacy of the inherent limits of emancipation, Adler shows that Theresienstadt succeeded in furthering the goals of the SS, propaganda goals, precisely because its existence could only be understood as a historical anomaly by the majority of those very Jews who were destined to wield influence in the ghetto. It was indeed exceptions and exceptionalism that had determined much of the emancipatory process itself, class-based, particularist, unpredictable, and that Adler points out would determine much of the character of the ghetto. The ghetto thus inadvertently became a point of confluence for SS special interests and, to some extent, the special interests of Jewish elites. Adler, who deliberately avoided the privileges to which his connections would normally have entitled him, is merciless in his exposure of the ways in which the self-deception of the Jews at Theresienstadt was part and parcel of the Nazi deception. If Auschwitz is the place where modernity's failures find their starkest and most horrifying expression, then Adler's Theresienstadt is where Jewish self-misrecognition finds its most fateful expression. A misrecognition in which the meaning of power, law, administration, and ethics are conflated. If Athens and Jerusalem, reason and revelation, are where the binaries of modernity locate themselves, then Theresienstadt is where the two intersect. It is the third city of modernity, and Adler's monograph is its ultimate guidebook. It is a place where the elite's misuse of ethics is justified by their maintenance of provisional power, and where the man of culture fails to recognize that he himself is implicated in the barbarism and violence of modernity if he fails to recognize that Athens and Jerusalem are actually interdependent. Adler's Theresienstadt book is not an account of Theresienstadt, but rather an ironic account of the Enlightenment's unfulfilled and unfulfillable promise. Adler's work in exposing the fissures in Jewish communality requires a double meaning. For the systems that had offered civic inclusion to the Jews had attempted to enforce universality while paradoxically enforcing individual and national rights. A modernity in which community is ideally able to tolerate the stressors of such differentiation is also a modernity in which the unassimilable aspects of a given people into the otherwise universalizing principle of particular nations could even become a question seeking a solution. Adler does not hold German and Jewish culpability on a par. Yet the Theresienstadt book offers nowhere that the ethical stability of the reader might gain a foothold. The accumulated evidence presented in the work shows that, as Adler says, the Jews had already come into the Nazi ideology's sphere of influence through, as he says, the mischief of a world in whose construction they had participated. Read in this way, the book might even suggest that the Nazi and Jewish models of salvation are dialectically relational in their stark opposition to each other. Yet rather than rejecting the idea of Jewish messianism in the middle of the Holocaust, Adler reintroduces Judaism's historic role as a means of resurrecting community at this catastrophic juncture in both Jewish and in world history. Indeed, he understood that this crisis only reestablished the necessity of a link, however tenuous, between reason and revolution that the Enlightenment, for all its good intentions, had badly severed. The Enlightenment, which had emphasized reason above all else, led to systems that took reason to limits so brutally rational that they begin to inhabit the ungraspable sphere of revelation. The messianic overtones of these systems are not lost on Adler, who writes, "The quest of the Jews, with its great revelations, aims to achieve concrete salvation for all of humanity, together and indivisible. The road to this salvation cannot be reconciled with the recognition of any doctrines that take salvation out of the empirical community and relegate it to a super-reality or a mystical reality of individual salvation, or that try in vain to force it through secular political action." At a time when old and new forms of anti-Semitism and anti-Judaism are asserting themselves, Adler's work bridges the rift between those who would claim the Holocaust as retribution for the sins of either religious particularism or sacrilegious assimilation. The publication of the Anglophone edition of this work at a time when we should avoid Holocaust hagiography at all costs might signal a new and urgently important era in Holocaust studies.
Except for a very few people who saw footnotes in Origins of Totalitarianism and other books, at least in the English language world, had not been in the conversation before Peter Philkin started translating his works about 7 or 8 years ago and more. And it's been a great pleasure for me to read the novels, and I want to thank him for that. I thought I'd begin by asking a simple question. I mean, this book that Amy has helped bring about the translation and editing of in English was published in 1955, first edition, second edition, 1960. It was pretty much universally recognized by people in the German-speaking world as brilliant, one of the most important documents of the Holocaust. It's cited by people like Hannah Arendt in her Origins of Totalitarianism, and yet it took 50 plus 60 years to be translated into English. And, you know, obviously there's going to be reasons for that are silly, like, you know, couldn't find the publisher or things like that. But I'm wondering if either of you think there are other reasons or if there are meaningful reasons of why it took so long, besides, you know, I know we talked before and you said something about, well, the publisher didn't push it. But I don't know, either of you have opinions about why this book took so long to get translated?
You know, my history with this book goes back to 1999. I will tell you that getting institutional backing for this was almost impossible. I will also tell you, let's put it this way. You don't need to have a European sensibility to be horrified by Auschwitz. I mean, this is an odd way of putting this. You do need, in order to understand Theresienstadt, you do need a sense of the trajectory of Jewish assimilation and Jewish acculturation, and some understanding of the categories of modernity that the Jews were trying to fit themselves into in a way that is not, it's not the same trajectory in Eastern Europe. The majority of what we think of as American Jewish culture is really informed by Eastern European Jewish culture. And I think this has a lot to do with why this book, problems aside, its size, the complexity of the translation, which Belinda will address, it's a very, very difficult book, and there's nothing black and white about it either. This is very, very important. It is not an us versus them. And Adler speaks about things in this book which are disturbingly accessible. They're inaccessible and accessible simultaneously because, of course, Theresienstadt is a warped mirror image of what we think of as a normal society. Auschwitz is something else, and it's so horrifying and so distant that there's a buffer zone there for anybody coming into this. Theresienstadt looks alarmingly like us, and that makes it very, very challenging to study. People are intrigued with the children's pictures that were produced there. Now the Holocaust music industry has become, you know, I myself am complicit. It's a big deal now. But something that resembles our society, that is familiar so closely, and to see that there was social stratification there, that there was favoritism, that there was, you know, connections and pull played a big role there, that there are chapter 8 in the beginning of the sociology section alone, it's a masterpiece of town planning. It's horrifying. It is this endless list of departments and offices and work detail, and it bears too close a resemblance to a familiar world.
All right, Jeremy, if you could talk about the experience. I don't know when you first read the book, the Theresienstadt book, but maybe how it impacted your view of your father and his writing, if that's something you'd be willing to talk about.
I can't remember when I first read the book, but it's always been with me throughout my life as a project which the family was engaged in. And my father sacrificed his time, his life, to create this monument. He took no paid work in order to be able to complete it, and then devoted himself to achieving publication. And I grew up as a child with all this going on around me. My parents shielded me from it, but there must have been a psychological level at which it impacted on me. So I can say it's always been with me, and I've seen it as a duty to carry on that work, not so much to my father, but to all the people who are memorialized in that text. The nature of it places it on a par in some respects with, only in some respects, with Primo Levi, who also had to wait an unendurable time for recognition. Levi's book is much shorter and much more accessible. This book is enormous and relatively inaccessible. So the time it took to come across to the States was much, much longer. I think that's all I can say immediately in response to the two questions.
We have time for one question if there's a question from the audience.
accessibility of the book. She commented on it being accessible while he commented on it being not accessible. Can you speak to your different opinions on that?
Did everyone hear the question? The question was about the accessibility of the Theresienstadt book. Amy had said that it was accessible, and Jeremy was just saying that it's sort of large and unwieldy and inaccessible. Either of you want to comment on what he meant by that?
I will comment very, very
briefly. Yeah, briefly. Just
very briefly. By accessible, I meant that if you work your way through the book, even just through the table of contents, you will recognize categories that will appear on the surface to be familiar. It's an extremely dense work, so in that respect, it's not accessible. But, yeah.
Just to add, I mean, I don't know how many of you know what Theresienstadt was, but it wasn't Auschwitz. It was a camp set up in a city. Many elite Jews and I think non-Jews as well were sent there. And so it much more resembled a real city, and therefore it's accessible, I think, is Amy what she's saying, in the way it was set up. And I think Jeremy's talking more about the form of the writing.
The book makes extreme demands on the reader because you have to engage with the text deeply to understand intellectually and to empathize emotionally with what the people went through. And that requires a high degree of participation from the audience. And that's what I meant by inaccessible. It doesn't sort of look up at you like a little dog and smile and say, here I am, stroke me. It's more like a piranha. You've got to be prepared to handle the difficult things in life. The difficult things in life. The difficult things in yourself. In order to engage with it and read it. That's what I meant.
We're gonna have time for more questions at the end, but I want to somewhat keep us on schedule because we have a really exciting program. So I'm going to now invite up my colleague Rufus Mueller and Lawrence Wallach to perform two of Victor Ullmann's songs based on Adler's poetry. This is, Amy referred to the Holocaust music industry. There were a lot of music and poems written in camps, but primarily in Theresienstadt, or mostly. And these are two, so please welcome Chris Miller and Mark Spock. The poems and translations are these Peter's translations, and the poems and Peter's translations are in your program if you'd like to follow along.
Just a little
hedge
note. Victor Ullmann studied with Schoenberg himself, and any musicians here will probably recognize that, the influences of his music. I make no apology for not performing these so much as reading them for you.
Thank you.
Translating the Holocaust, not to make this simply about H.G. Adler and his work, or simply about the scholarship, or simply about the novels. And it was wonderful to have the opportunity to bring the music into the performance. And And then we have the great generous offer of Bill Hugh Jones to speak about a piece that he has, a new dance work that he has been working on that ties to the Holocaust. I just want to say that seems particularly appropriate to expand it beyond the author and to include Bill Hugh Jones and work that is going on as we speak in the contemporary setting. Bill.
Thank you very much. More comfortable on my feet, actually, and I don't know what they didn't plan on being here, but I need them. What are we doing? I have been with my companion, who is now my husband, for 22 years. I've met his mother, Dora, at the beginning of our relationship. Over time, she says that she has three sons, her son Ronnie, Paris, there's Bjorn, I'm alone, my companion, my husband, and she says, I am her other son. Now this is important. In coming into anyone's milieu, family milieu, you learn a lot. And I've grown up, my first partner, Ani Zane, was New York Jewish. They spoke New York Yiddish. His mother came from a family of rabbis, but as we've learned, it's a different thing. Dora is born in Strasbourg, starting in Poland. Bjorn's father comes from Belarusia. So when I came into this picture, I was hearing her, I believe I get this right, opening up. She is 95 now. When I did the oral history, she was maybe 80. She was telling stories, as you know how we do as we get older. Many times she was telling stories, and some of them, Bjorn tells me he had never heard before. She talked about that war as it was yesterday. So I said, as a gift to her sons, could you please sit down with me and the video and let me record an oral history? 15 years go by, I've been reading W.G. Sebald. Very great, great gift to me. And I was much taken with The Immigrants. It tells four stories. Each story, ironically enough, is built around a person who ends up actually taking their life. And the seeds of their distress is always in the past. There's something going on in the past. So I thought that I would stage that first. But as I was struggling with this immense novel, It's accessible, but it is deep in its implications. I thought, well, why are you struggling so hard to evoke this novelistic, poetic space? Where are these stories in your life? Dora, she talks all the time about shuttling back and forth with different memories. So I sat her down, and it's going to be, this Dora piece will be followed by a piece about my nephew, that seems to preoccupy me more and more as I understand what we've done with Dora. So I've asked Tally Jackson and Shirley B. Jenkins to recreate just a tiny bit of the text. You have to imagine that they are actually moving as they do what they're about to recite to you. But what you hear are two voices. You hear Bill's voice, and you hear Dora's voice.
You want to use one mic?
No, just do it. Whatever you feel comfortable with. They want to do the physical because it helps with the memory, I think.
So, Dora, you were in the countryside working on the farm, and you knew you were not going to stay there.
No.
I think what we should next talk about is your development and how...
How I entered the work saving the Jews. Yes, this began in 42, just before Passover, and ended in December 43. In the beginning of 42, this organization, OSE.
What's that?
OSE, O-S-E, which means Organization for Saving the Children. It's one of the several organizations sanctioned by the Vichy government, mostly for foreign Jews. OSE had organized a concentrated nursing course for a group of Jewish girls in Marseille, and I was invited to participate. However, the day of the opening was also the closing.
What do you mean?
The prefecture of Marseille, which had to give authorization for such a course, said Jewish girls are not allowed to have this profession.
And you were not expecting this?
No, it was totally unexpected. And this woman from Ose, Andre.
Who?
Andre Salomon. She came to us to make a speech about what the camps were.
Camps?
Yes, Gers and Rivesaltes. We were all horribly shocked. And somehow I felt that she would ask me to go there. And she did. I immediately said yes.
So fast? You were ready?
I took the train to Rivesaltes the next day or the day after.
Would you go back just for the record to describe these camps? Because many people, when they hear camps, they think concentration camps.
In France, enemy nationals were always put in what was called résidence assignée, assigned residence. But this cannot be called residence. This was internment. And these internees were called the fifth column.
Yes, and this was code word for traitors and saboteurs.
Yes. The easiest thing to do was to put them all in the same basket and send them over to France, and then the French took them and put them in those camps. These so-called enemies were more against the Hitler regime than many French at the time, and that was nonsense.
Thank you. Meeting Dora, who is a non-religious person, she speaks in this kind of Cartesian, logical way. One of those frustrating things about Dora is that I have been knowing her for 21 years and I've never seen her cry. And she can tell the most astounding things and she never cries. So that's what's wonderful about the story. But one of the things that I'm concerned with as an artist is what can movement and abstraction do. So we've tried indeterminacy. We've tried all sorts of things, and now I'm really honing in on narratives and oral histories. Dora was 19 when the war started. Some of my dancers are not much older than that. There's something about looking backwards. I work in a place called New York Live Arts, and there is a feeling from very young artists we, my generation, spends too much time thinking about the past, forms, and content. So I was thinking, how do I have it my way? I love the writing of Siebold talking about that war. I love hearing Dora's stories, and I love Dora, I love my company. How can I put these two impulses together? So if you're able to follow Dora's story, those of you who will see the work I do, I encourage you to come. I think we're doing it next week on what day?
12th.
And it will be premiered at the Kassler Theater, three performances in Montclair, New Jersey on June 18th and run for a few nights. But trying to look here and understand that this is supposed to be greater than the sum of its parts. Am I doing a Holocaust piece? You know, I didn't think I was. I thought I was doing a piece about a woman who had met a challenge in life and that she was going to find a way to get through it, and she does. I wanted to hear my young dancers voice that. What does it mean to be cool under fire? How dare you, Dora, come out of that war and say that people are basically good? She did. I'm bitter as hell yet about slavery. I'm really angry. I've accepted that I'm always going to be angry. And here you have this woman whose her mother's side of the family, they were all deported to Auschwitz, and she still tells me stories about the German officer who, there's many stories. One story is she's supposed to take two young girls to another place, says, don't talk, because all they could do was speak German. And she was, the train was full of Germans. They sit down in the car to get something to eat. Sure enough, the German officer comes and sits down right with them. The girls pretend that they're deaf or mute or don't understand. And he wants to talk about his family, his village. He hasn't heard from his wife, his children. So I ask her, I say, so he was rather sentimental. She said, yes, you see, we're all much more alike than different. Form and meaning, memory, and dignity. Dignity. Dora has a natural dignity. The next story that I'm doing, I have to mention it, Roger, is about my nephew. Talk about community. Do you believe that old saw that it takes a village to raise a child? Well, then in the case of my nephew, we failed. My nephew was 46 years old, cocaine addict, male prostitute, who has lost the use of his legs and may very well be dead when his piece is premiered 2 years from now. What happened? Talk about community. And there are wars and wars and wars. His war right now is just to get to the wheelchair. My war is to live this life and not be consumed by anger. There are wars, and there are wars. So is this a Holocaust piece? This is about something that I think actually unites the Holocaust to human experience. Who says this? Frank O'Hara? The only truth is face to face. What about the German officer and the man taking his glasses off? Do you, the Jewish people in the room, really believe that the only truth is face to face? I'm still struggling with it. Dora seems to have figured that out, and she has the right to believe it. I feel like I'm spouting something that's not very well understood. I think there's not much more to say other than I'm greatly honored to be here today, very moved by the story of your father, and very moved by your passion in translating. And I am learning a great deal, and thank you very much.
Is to talk about actually working on Adler's text. Linda as translator, maybe on the end, Linda? Linda is translator of the Theresienstadt book, which will appear this November, a very daunting and monumental task that she's undertaken. And as I mentioned at the beginning, I'm a translator of Adler's novel, so I thought we'd start with Linda first, and then Wyatt and Cecile will be responding.
I really appreciate the invitation to be here. When I translate, as a translator, one tends to work in isolation, so it's good to be with the people who are also interested in this work, most interested in this work. I've been working on this. Amy first came to me, I think, 15 years ago, so it's been quite a long process. And I don't usually talk about translation, so it's a little bit unusual for me to be sort of discussing the process, so I'm not sure if what I'm going to say is going to be as impressive as some of the other things that have been said here, but I'd like to talk a little bit about the sort of the mechanics of it and what made this a particularly daunting or substantive task. When Amy first came to me, I didn't realize what I was getting into. Definitely didn't realize what I was getting into. I had translated quite a number of Holocaust-related works. I come out of my father was a Holocaust survivor, so I come out of a family that's been sort of steeped in the Holocaust, and you've been doing work on this for years. But this was something different. This is an 800-page manuscript. I didn't know very much about Theresienstadt. I'm not a Theresienstadt scholar. I didn't know, I don't know anything about music. That's not my field. I didn't know many things about many of the things in this book. This is a huge work that has sections on nutrition, on health, on the law. The law I know something about. I have a law degree, but it has sections on pretty much sociology, psychology. I'm not any of those things. I'm not a philosopher. So taking on a translation that has all of that in it, of course, is daunting. And it's a little bit different, though, from what Peter's going to tell you, because it's not quite the same as translating fiction. Translating nonfiction, you can usually take somewhat more liberty with the text than you can with fiction. Although with Adler, it's a little bit different because my sense was that he really did think about how he was writing this work. And I noticed when I was going over recently, 15 years later, I've been sent the entire manuscript, the 800 pages, to edit. And one of the editors had taken out, for example, some of his exclamation points. In the interest of greater readability, greater comprehensibility. And looking at it, I thought, I don't know, I want to be faithful to what he was, to his way of expressing himself. So that's always something that comes up in translation with nonfiction, not usually as much as with fiction, but in this case it did. Just to throw out a few of the issues, because I don't want to talk for very long, obviously, but just a few of the things that come up when you're translating a work of this size and this complexity. Again, not necessarily unique to Adler, but unique in the sense that this is it's a huge work and it's a particularly complex work. One, of course, is consistency. When you work on a text for 15 years, an 800-page text for 15 years, when you have a number of people involved, some of the chapters were rough translated by other people, you really do have an issue with consistency, with keeping the translations as similar as possible. We make decisions when we translate words and phrases. Sometimes those decisions change over the years. When I came to a later portion of the text, I sometimes understood what he was trying to say in a different way, and therefore translated a word or phrase differently. That, of course, means going back and making sure that that's happening throughout the text. So that's just a very practical issue in any text. The vocabulary, of course. Adler the German he uses is Czech influenced. It's Czech German. And that meant that there were words and phrases that I had never come across. I lived in Berlin for a very long time. My German, the German I speak, is what's spoken in Germany. Words came up that I'd never heard before. And fortunately, I had people I could ask, but words like Ubikation, never heard that word before. It apparently means quarters or accommodations. Never heard it before. Or one that's rather nice, and this is also has to do with technology. There's a word that, Burgdom, which is a particular kind of food, a Czech food, that came up in the nutrition chapter. It turns out that it's a sweet roll. The reason I actually know that now is because 15 years ago, I probably wouldn't have Googled it. A few weeks ago, I Googled it, and there were pictures of Buchtel, and now I know what they are, I know what they look like. But that's part of the issue, is also the words that were used that aren't always familiar to me. The question of whether to translate something or not to translate when presenting it in English. There's a word that he uses very often, Schleuse. In Theresienstadt, as I understand it, there was an area where when people were brought into the camp, they were, in a sense, quarantined in a particular area. It's called the Schleuse, and then they came out into the camp. A direct translation would be something like airlock, but it didn't seem to make sense to translate. We've used the word Schleuse as it was. But those are the kind of, again, decisions of whether to leave things in German because there isn't really a perfect translation and the word works best in German. The question of Nazi language, and this comes up in many Holocaust translations. The Nazis use language in very weird ways. They use euphemisms, they use words that euphemistically. Adler has a lot of words and phrases in quotation marks. And sometimes it's difficult to render the irony sometimes or the weirdness of the German. And I should say I'm not happy with all the decisions I made in this translation by any means. This is a place where it's often difficult. We were just talking about this the other day, for example, this question. There's a word, Stand. Standmeldung, Standlisten. The Nazis counted all the time. They were constantly counting people, making sure what the numbers were. When people were coming in, people were going out, they were constantly checking to see how many people were there. It's a strange word, and it's used over and over again. Adler had a glossary at the beginning of the book that we didn't actually include. And I'm not sure we should have or we shouldn't have, but it's a little bit difficult because it's really about words, and if you don't have the original German word, it doesn't make a lot of sense. But the word Stand was listed, was one of the words he had in the glossary, and I think he was also, my sense was that he was trying to show the weirdness of that word and of that constant counting. Difficult to figure out how to translate it again. These are, they mean something, but they're also euphemistic. So just getting that across in the translation, it often doesn't work, but it's something you always kind of want to do. I don't know if anybody's ever read the Victor Klemperer book, LTI, which is about the language of the Third Reich. I don't know how you would translate that book, but it's all about that strange use of language. I think that's all I'll say for now, but I just say that some of the, among the words he puts in quotation marks are words like ghetto. Just the word ghetto, Theresienstadt is a ghetto. He always has that in quotation marks. Because even calling it a ghetto is a not a quite correct way of talking about a place that's that horrid. So I think I'll stop there, obviously, if anyone has questions.
I'll talk for a moment about translating the novels, because again, I think one of the unique things about Adler is this fusion of scholarship and scientific approach with a literary approach. Adler is 32 years old in 1942 when he enters Theresienstadt. He has a doctorate, as Jeremy mentioned. So he is a fully trained writer, intellectual. He'd already published a book of poems. He was already writing short stories, had drafts of novels going. And so this is someone who was not so much shaped by the Holocaust experience, but his sensibility was deepened and extended. And I think that's very important. He had a very much a shaped sensibility entering the camps, and he found a way to employ that sensibility and face the experience that he had. The astounding thing, in the same time that he is writing the Theresienstadt book, which is 850 pages long, and there's a second sequel to it called Theresienstadt Documenta, which is gatherings of the documents that he collected. At the same time he's doing all of this scholarship, he writes seven novels. And as you can see, very substantive novels simultaneously. So both of these ventures are happening. And in translating his novels, you have to remember that. You have to remember that there's a scholarly, scientific sensibility behind the novels, and that he is, when Jeremy talked about releasing the inner dignity or paying homage to the inner dignity of the victims, that is very much the project of the novels themselves. The astonishing thing is not only that he writes seven novels, but there are seven novels, each with a different style. And then you will have different tones and different voices. Jeremy talked about the use of montage and breaking up the narrative as it goes through, and this happens in the novels themselves. His first one, Panorama, 1948, is very much modeled on a Bildungsroman, coming-of-age story. And it's much more realistic and naturalistic. It's broken up into 10 chapters dealing with the life of Josef Kramer. And there are 10 different moments in his life where he's a little boy on a farm out in the country. He's at a terrible school. He becomes a university student. He ends up forcibly conscripted to work on a railroad, and then he ends up in a camp called Langenstein, where Adler himself naturally was. But when you're reading the novel, you don't know these things are going to happen. You're just following a little boy's life. And I'll read you just one little bit from it. This is Joseph at 8 years old, and he's fond of Fritz and his ability to whittle, to carve wood. And Joseph feels, Joseph isn't as good, having cut his finger once while he was carving in the open fields, the finger bleeding for so long that Joseph had to wrap his handkerchief around it. While that night, Herma made a proper bandage, carefully washing the finger at first and rubbing it with alcohol so that it wouldn't get infected, though it burned like hell. Herman saying that it was just what that was just what had to be, because there had
once been a farm boy in Umlovitz who also cut himself, and no one did anything about the wound, such that the poor boy got a terrible illness called tetanus, and the next day he was dead, since there was nothing that could be done for him. And so Joseph held his finger still, not wanting to get any tetanus, and 2 days later the finger was fine again and hadn't gotten infected. So it's a very apocryphal, very naive story of a little boy being scared that he's going to get this thing called tetanus. Except you realize as you read the novel later on, to get a severe cut or a severe wound in the camps was a death sentence very often. So this is an allusion that's going to leap way ahead to the novel. So you have a skilled literary novelist, literary artist at work here, shaping the narrative, choosing what is left in, what is left out. These are not simply novels of memory. They're not simply novels of author's experience. He said that they were novels steeped in biography, but they were not biography. That if he ever wrote his biography, his memoirs, which he intended to do, but never did, that would be something related, but quite different. And then you go to a novel of the second one that he completes after the war, called Einreise, or The Journey, as he intended to call it, Die Reise. And you get a voice like this: all that had been forbidden in the world now meant nothing. This is a novel about the deportations from Prague, though Prague is never mentioned. The deportations to Theresienstadt, the experience of Theresienstadt. Theresienstadt is never mentioned. Names are made up for these places, and it follows the journey of a family through the deportations. And he makes this sort of grand, large claim of the import of the actions. All that had been forbidden in the world now meant nothing, for it had never been a law, but rather an arrangement that rested on enforced custom. What was once taken in stride now appeared all of a piece to the law, which had the last word and did not allow anything to contradict it. Life was reduced to force, and the natural consequence was fear, which was bound up with constant danger in order to rule life through terror. So note the philosophical, political, sociological language, right? Now, you experienced what you never had before. You rejoiced over that which you were allowed, but even this did not last for long, because any such comforts had only to be noticed, and the next day they were taken away. Thus, the tender, juicy meat was taken away, since you who are made of flesh need no meat. Then they banned fat, for your belly was full of fat. They denied you vegetables, for they stunk when they rotted. They ripped chocolate out of your hands, fruit and wine as well. You were told that there wasn't any more. So now we're in the voice of the oppressors talking about this ubiquitous you, which is laced with insults and oppressive kinds of ideas and characterizations. It goes on. Highways and byways were forbidden. The days were shortened and the nights lengthened. Not to mention that the night was forbidden and the day forbidden as well. Shops were forbidden, doctors, hospitals, vehicles, and resting places forbidden, all forbidden. Laundries were forbidden, libraries were forbidden, music was forbidden, dancing forbidden, shoes forbidden, baths forbidden, and as long as there still was money, it was forbidden. What was and what could be were forbidden. It was announced, what you can buy is forbidden and you can't buy anything. Since people could no longer buy anything, they wanted to sell what they had, for they hoped to eke out a living from what they made off their belongings. Yet they were told, what you can sell is forbidden, and you are forbidden to sell anything. Thus everything became sadder, and they mourned for their lives, but they didn't want to take their lives, because that was forbidden. And it's that lovely turn on Phil Bolton there, being told, this is forbidden, that's forbidden. And they don't take their lives because that's morally forbidden within themselves. And so the for Bolton, which has been layered, musically arranged, by the way, too. I mean, it happens in the German, for Bolton, for Bolton, for Bolton. It goes through the entire paragraph. And it's Adler subtly turns it right at the end to restore, again, the dignity of the victims that Jeremy talks about. In the third novel, the question that really interests me all the way through is, where is Adler in all of this? Often he's in the middle of the narrative, often he is behind the narrative. And in the Wall deals with its protagonist, Arthur Landau, who has survived the camps, lost his wife, remarries, moves to a place very much like London and is in the post-war world of exile and trying to deal with the past and finding he can't go forward without dealing with the past, but he can't deal with the past in order to go forward. He's caught in between. And in some ways, this is true of Adler, but he's also on the outside being able to deal with it by writing fiction, by writing scholarship, by writing poetry. I just wanted as an object. These are his collected poems, which came out 3 years ago, 1,200 pages long, most of which, I mean, 99% of which did not appear in his lifetime, but which he collected together in volumes and dated the poems. And talk about writing for the drawer, writing for the future. This was someone very much doing that. Where does Adler stand in all of this? I think what Arthur says about himself and the wall is true for Hans-Gunther Adler as well. I think of myself as something that is split into pieces, but not something pathological, because the pieces also are linked to one another, though this is questionable. The split apart pieces know of one another, they just aren't joined up. Can you understand when I say that I am not my own master, and therefore am split, but without being sick? Look, this was particularly true when everything seemed questionable, not just me alone, for that would easily have been pathological, but instead the questionable became dominant in an environment where, for many, the questionable was transformed into that which could not be questioned, because doing so cast them down and ate them up. Perhaps I have simply ensconced myself within nothingness and cannot exist in any other way. On the other hand, the other side of Adler that I find is the one, if I get my page number, the one who also says, you have to be able to feel broken and yet not damn the world. To not become callous, not hate your neighbor, not the guilty, for they are your neighbors. You can't separate them from those who are not guilty. Doubt and lack of faith are two very different things. Beware the one who exchanges one for the other or mixes them up. Avoid negation and embrace the end. Even praise it, for the end is also a gift and is part of the plan. At the end, you submit yourself and accept your fate. And I'll leave it at that.
The literature of the catastrophe is now complete. And he said this in 1953. This was the same year that Yad Vashem was created as Israel's central organ for Holocaust commemoration and documentation. And when Yivo and Yad Vashem published their first volume of their joint bibliographic series 7 years later, that is in 1960, the eminent Jewish historian Selah Barone noted that, quote, the overwhelming plethora of eyewitness accounts and vast material accumulated had allowed for the creation of an authoritative guide to Holocaust studies. So by now, we know this long-held idea that discussion and writing about the Holocaust didn't really begin in earnest until after the Eichmann trial in 1962. We know now that this is really false. And moreover, there was in fact a veritable flood of writing during the war itself, and then from the moment of liberation virtually onward. So, as we was mentioned earlier, Adler's study of Theresienstadt was first published in 1955. So why were these early works on the Holocaust, and I'm thinking primarily of scholarship, and memoir, why were they so little recognized for so long? And considering the theme or the title of today's event, I would argue that language and translation are one very important aspect to understanding this question. Strigler's own work that I alluded to at the beginning was written in Yiddish, which was the native language of a majority of Holocaust victims. Most of the ghettos and camps were located in Poland, and many Polish sources for studying the Holocaust were subject to restrictions for many years by the post-war communist regime in that country. Now, even today, a majority of scholars who study the Holocaust come from the field of German studies and are only trained in West European languages, and that limits the sources to which they have access. Now, of course, Adler's case is somewhat different since he wrote in German. So the question is perhaps why this work in particular was under-recognized, at least under-translated, shall we say, not translated until very recently. So I'd like to just come back to a question that Roger and Amy discussed in the first session, that given the fact that most Holocaust scholars are coming from the perspective of German history, the questions they're asking have long been primarily questions about the perpetrators and sources that shed light on the experience of the victims and the perspective of the victims in general tended to be overlooked. So as Amy mentioned, the Theresienstadt itself was of course unique. It was somewhere between a ghetto and a camp. It was neither one nor the other, but particularly in the ghettos, which existed as Theresienstadt did in many cases for a number of years and really formed complete societies or communities, that to really understand the internal dynamic and the dilemmas faced by the leadership of these so-called coerced communities, to use Adler's term, really required a knowledge, a familiarity of the internal processes of Jewish history and Jewish community, whether in Yiddish, Polish, or German, or Czech, or many other languages we could name. So I would argue that this question of language and translation is really crucial to understanding the Holocaust and understanding how scholars have approached its many angles. So it's all the more valuable that the work of Adler is now being made available to an English-speaking audience. One of the things I find the most striking about Adler's work, as I think is apparent to all of us here today, is just its sheer scope. I can think of many other examples of, particularly in the ghettos, where during the war itself there were efforts to document on a wide scale the experience of the residents of the ghettos, either as group efforts, as in the case of the Warsaw and Lodz ghettos, or individual initiatives such as that of Herman Crook in the Vilna ghetto. And there were also figures who moved beyond collecting sources to go to produce analysis of the wartime experience even during the war itself. So Emanuel Ringelblum, who was the head of the Onik Shabbos archive in the Warsaw ghetto, not only oversaw a vast project to document the life of that ghetto, but amazingly he composed his study Polish-Jewish relations during the Second World War in 1943, while he was in hiding on the Aryan side. I can also think of many examples of writers who wrote both memoir and fiction. Strigler, who I mentioned, is just one example, but I really can't think of a figure besides Adler who collected a vast amount of material on the ghetto, primary sources, and wrote novels and poetry and scholarship. Perhaps there were others, but I'm just not aware of them, and I find it remarkable. So finally, I just wanted to, Belinda has already touched on this theme of the distinct language, but I just wanted to underline that Adler himself, in the Theresienstadt study, emphasizes this sense in which language itself becomes meaningless in the context of his experiences and the Holocaust in general. And I just to read, I think it's worth reading a quote from him, from the work, any words must be insignificant to portray this improbable and dreamlike chaos in which all standards were confused and distorted. Or one more quote here, even in this world, language endeavored to form verbal constructions as it might in a normal community, but here the words meant nothing real. They no longer expressed a reality. What did construction and consolidation mean here? So I think, I had other questions which you partly addressed about how you convey a clear text to an English reader, but at the same time, the sense of the perversion of language that Adler himself emphasizes is part of the system. So I have some other examples, but I don't know whether it's worth taking. Yeah. So just finally, I would just the last point I wanted to make was you know, it's interesting that when he discusses this process of beautification of the ghetto or the camp, however you want to call it, which was unique to Theresienstadt, because Theresienstadt was designed as a kind of show place for visiting dignitaries so that they could be shown that Jews were being well treated under the Nazis. He describes in great detail this physical process of what's called beautification of Theresienstadt, but he also talks about how this is mirrored in the language itself, so that the physical transformation of the camp is mirrored in the transformation of language. So he's very quickly, he says, the name ghetto was eliminated and replaced by Jewish settlement area. The ghetto guard became the community guard. Transport numbers were not eliminated, but now they were innocently called identification numbers, and so on. So just with that in mind, I was thinking perhaps you could reflect some more on how you know, sort of find that balance between this sort of uncanniness of language and the way language itself functions. I'm also just curious whether the two of you, working in different genres of Adler's work, whether you discussed or had any discussions about your the approaches to his work. So thank you very much.
It's striking, the breadth of Adler's accomplishment. And it occurred to me that perhaps one of the impediments to his having the ability to leap across and have a reputation in English is that very breadth. For many artists, like it or not, will get pigeonholed for a particular thing that they do, become known for it, and either complicit in it or not, perpetuate that very thing. We can think of many artists who are said to be writing the same opera, writing the same novel. It seems like Adler was trying desperately not to write the same novel, trying desperately not to repeat the same research and scholarship, but rather to originate and find very different forms for expressing the inexpressible. I wonder, since we're completely unfamiliar with this opus, if you could give us just a sense of its form, its structure, and if, in response, you could talk about the, you say that there are seven novels,
Yeah. And
they're all in different styles. I'm very curious about that idea when you say, where is Adler? If we're, as a room, getting to hear Adler's voice for the first time in English, and we're trying to get an idea, not a diluted, simplified sense of Adler, which sounds like it would be impossible, but rather put together a sense of what these different formal responses to, as Jeremy was saying, to Joyce and Faulkner in the novels themselves. Can you give us a sense of the form of these books before we talk about the style, if they're not interdependent?
Yeah, the Theresienstadt book is, I think, five or six chapters of history of the ghetto, of Theresienstadt. Then, oh man, how many chapters, I think, how many chapters is the sociology section? 8 to 17, yeah. So all of those chapters individually are about a different, they're about maybe 50 pages each about a specific aspect of the ghetto. So nutrition, law, medicine, sociology, the administrative structure. And yeah, right, 20 of the psychology. Administrative structure, I'm spacing now, but welfare, children, culture, you know, all the different aspects of the ghetto, and with huge numbers of statistics, huge numbers of specific, detailed discussions of, you know, the nutrition chapter has page after page of a list of how many calories they were getting, the prisoners were getting at any one time over the years of the ghetto. That's how specific it is. What diseases people were dying from. It's extraordinarily specific in its discussion, its portrayal. And the last chapter, the 20th chapter, is a long chapter on the psychology of the ghetto, which is more or less a lot of what Amy was talking about, his feelings about his views of what was happening on a larger scale. But that's the structure of the book. That's the basic structure.
Yeah, I referred to it, the structure is constantly shifting within the novels and across the novels. A late novel, House
Hausordnung is a very satirical novel. It's about the rules of the build of the apartment building and playing upon the bureaucracy of modern apartment buildings. It even comes with a set of rules that folds out as a poster, published in 1988. And you know, Panorama is very pastoral. The journey is very almost magical realism in a certain sense. And then The Wall is a much more psychological novel where you're in the middle of a cocktail party and then all of a sudden he's remembering back to walking through the Bohemian forest with his first wife, or he's, you know, complaining or working on his book on the sociology of repressed people, which is clearly the Theresienstadt book. So it's really a novel of post-war exile. So I think you're right, Wyatt. He's not content to rest in any one form. The Ansiedlung is a novel that's not published, which means the settlement, and it's kind of George Orwell meets Franz Kafka as a science fiction novel. The clocks run backwards, and sick people are put on display in the town windows to encourage other people not to get sick. It's just bizarre, but wonderful at the same time too. So he is restless, he is constantly shifting his concerns, and then ultimately there's a kind of nobly failed project. He has to keep trying a different way and realizes ultimately, obviously, you can't quite get to it all. I was very glad to hear Bill T. Jones mention Zabel, because in Zabel's Austerlitz, Adler appears. Austerlitz wants to find out more about Theresienstadt, where his mother died, and he reads Adler's book in a very famous 12-page long sentence in German. German is good at doing. And I think Zabel is ultimately saying, as a non-victim, as someone who is not in the war, I can take you so far. If you want to go further, you're going to have to go to Adler. And I think Adler is saying, I can take you as far as I can, and I will take you as many different ways that I can, but obviously this darkness is too big for any one form or one sensibility.
Sebald has mentioned more American readers certainly know Sebald's work at this point than Adler. The Sebaldian sentence has been a source of great interest to readers in English. Sebald worked with his translators of his prose to hone that into an English that resembled his German. So we have a sense of a Sebaldian sentence. It's full of deferrals and qualifications, layered quotation with comma clauses. He said, she said, he told me, he continued, often in a row before nesting these ideas of whose story it is. So the Sebaldian sentence is always quoting and re-quoting and quoting further. Is there such a thing as an Adlerian sentence at this point that you could share with us in either the nonfiction or the fiction?
Yeah, I do think so. In the end, stream of consciousness is really important to him. In Panorama, after I finished translating, I actually looked at the statistics, how many pages, how many words I had worked on. And I noticed that there were, you know, 450 pages and 480 paragraphs, which meant that basically every paragraph was a page long, and in fact, every paragraph is one sentence. And he broke it up with semicolons, so I would render that, I'd have to break the periods where the semicolons were, English couldn't sustain it, but I would use tricks of the continual presence to keep the sentence rolling. And so you always have this stream of consciousness in which the narrative is being spoken, but there's Adler behind the narrative, you know, that little thing about the tetanus. You see him very consciously handle that with a verboten. So there's an inner meditative sentence that he is most fond of, I would say. I don't know, in the scholarship limit?
I'm thinking about his sentences are also very long, but nothing, I don't have anything sort of specific. And he uses a lot of quotes, so there's a lot of breaking up of the text and a lot of statistical material. So he doesn't, except in that last psychology chapter, which is very dense and long, long sentences, I think, probably more like the literature.
Have you found there to be any questions? I'm just going to follow up on that, just another thing about that. Have you found there to be anything particularly challenging about, other than the things that you raised for us, that's very different about Adler and translating his work from prior work that you've translated? project in some fundamental way?
It's not entirely different, except that I do think he has, in parts of the book, he has what Peter was saying, sort of a very long sentence, very thoughtful, but sentences you really have to think about it a lot. And it's not the only author that you have to think about, but with him, there's more there. I think there's more going on, even in the nonfiction, a lot more thought than in most other types of writing, where nonfiction writing tends to be pretty straightforward. Even if the sentences are long, the ideas are straightforward, but not with other.
Roger, do you want to
Open it up? Why don't we open it up to you all for some questions? We have a short period, but we can go a couple. We got 10, 15 minutes, so two or three more questions, and we'd love to hear from you. Yes, and if you could stand up, and I'll try and. Yes, please.
I wanted to ask about language, and I wanted to ask about irony, his use of irony, because I find that the passage that you read, I think, was very expressive of his kind of irony and the way that he, in a way, reacts to the kind of distortion of language, the beautification of language by the Nazis and the euphemism by a kind of double reversal, right? Like, irony functions as a kind of mirroring, where he throws back at you how the Nazis distort the language, but he also goes a step further and sort of does something really interesting with irony. And if you have anything to say to that, either of you.
I think it's a very astute observation. The Verboten passage is the classic example of that. In The Wall, Arthur Landau works in a post-war museum, and he's taking care of portraits of ancestors of the victims that have been deposited in the museum, and he has to carry the portraits up and downstairs from the basement, and the word is schleppen, that he's geschleppt, and of course we know a schlepper was someone who was charged with hauling the bodies and into the crematoriums and things like that. So I cannot help but think, as he's hauling these portraits, schleppen, these portraits up and down the stairs, that Adler is very consciously using that. And I think you're right, he's trying to restore that language to some reality, to unmask its perverseness, and then take back that verboten. I think one of the most astounding things about Adler, when I finished the first novel I translated, I had to write an introduction, and I sat down and said, well, who is he like? You know, what other survivor of the camps writing in German, writing novels? And I couldn't come up with anybody. And it turns out, and this is a very specific category, a German-speaking novelist who wrote novels about their direct experience of the camps. There's four. There's Jürgen Becker, Jakob the Liar. He was in Sachsenhausen. You have Fred Vondt, who writes a novel called The Seventh Well, but does it much later. It's really kind of a memoir. And then Edgar Hilsenroth, who writes about being in the Ukraine. And an important qualification is auf Deutsch, right? In other words, to play with the German in this way, to play with the Nazi German too. And I love your notion of irony being a mirroring. The other thing I would underscore with that is immense amount of humor in others. Dark humor, gallows humor, black humor, but it's versus atrocity. Very little atrocity, very little grotesqueness, but always a kind of underlying sardonic humor waiting to erupt.
Thank you.
I think the only thing in the nonfiction is, as I said, the use of quotation marks. He does it much more straightforwardly. It's not a literary work in the same way.
But it's also the case that the whole of the tea book, it's full of irony. It's full of irony. I mean, the ridiculousness of the details, and he piles, it's overwhelming. I want to know exactly how many spoonfuls of jam women between the ages of 35 and 50 were allowed in this particular barracks during the winter of 43-44. It's in there. That's ironic. Yeah. Right away, that's ironic.
Yeah, and I think the schema of the structure of the camp is 17 pages long. Just the structure.
Yeah.
I mean, it's insane.
He called the form of irony that he uses in The Journey lyrical irony.
Mm-hmm.
That was his notion, that he has a kind of lyricism floating through the novel, but at the same time, practically everything is being ironized. Your notion there is very good. He's switching back between the victims ironizing the guards and the other way around. And very often, the Nazis are allowed, they're never mentioned by name, the Nazis or the Jews. He just lets the experiences talk. And he lets the Nazis refer to themselves by the terms that they themselves preferred, such as the heroes. And of course, there are then immediately ironized by their own words and damned by their own self-description.
If I could just speak to that point really quick, that when the heroes come up in The Journey, this notion of irony, it was how to introduce how he's using this term. And this is where, as a translator, you interfere a little bit. And for a couple of places initially, I called them the mighty heroes, right? In the sense of their feeling of being so mighty and in control. So this is what you have to do as a translator to sometime perform what the irony that's going on.
Yes, in the back. Can you stand up?
Following up the question and your comments, I'm wondering whether you could speak to the fact whether there was some sort of, to what extent there was an interaction to the poetry in the early 50s that was doing exactly this literary irony in the German language, such as Ernst Jandl with the Schützengraben, or with Helmut Heißenbüttel, or with other poets that had, let's say, a shared project of reclaiming the language in a way that would work with the words and reclaim the words that have been abused and compartmentalized by the lingua tertia imperii, by the language of the Third Reich. And connected to that is a follow-up question on what Peter Filkins mentioned, the rewriting of the same book that doesn't come to an end. And I was wondering whether you could speak to a context, whether there was context in Adler's work with other writers who show the same sort of project that doesn't come to an end, with like Primo Levi, who wrote the same book four or five times, with others such as Jean-Marie, who wrote the same book five, six, seven times, or Wolfgang Hildesheimer, who wrote the same book five, six, seven times. Whether there was an encounter of that sort of experience writing after the Holocaust.
On the matter of the poetry, he certainly knew personally both Jandl and Heißenbüttel. And Heißenbüttel was one of his most important editors in the radio for several of the essays that he wrote. There is an affinity to the contemporary movements in language insofar as they all look at the materiality of language in their poems. But that's about the limit of the analogy. After that, H.G. Adler's poetry is very different, much more rich and recondite, rhythmically far more traditional, going back to Hermeling, which is exactly where Heißenbüttel and Jandl want to escape from. Mm-hmm. As to your question about books, it's slightly different from those writers. He's not rewriting the same novel in the set text, but he's going over the same material. His projects are interlocking. One book interlocks with another. He doesn't repeat the physical experience or the subjective experience from one novel to the next. One novel will lead you up to this point, the next novel will take you to another point. Another feature is that each of the novels is differently written. They all use a different style. They use a different rhythm. Each book has its own rhythm, and it's unique to that book. So it's not a set, you don't get repetition in the sense that you do with those other novelists.
If I could just add to that, I think the other element is the scholarship, that he's writing the same experience through the scholarship as well. So he had the benefit of these multiple genres and took full advantage of them, and they're happening simultaneously. We haven't had a chance to mention just but fleetingly the 1,200-page volume that comes out in 1974, the Verbata Dementia, Administered Man, which is a detailed study of the entire deportation system. Adler said he wrote the Theresienstadt book as an act of self-liberation, and he
did the administered man as from the outside in. He wrote the Theresienstadt book from the inside out, having experienced that, and the administered man was more of a scholarly work, conceptualizing the entire system. His last book is a book on religion, and an experimental theology, which was actually his first book. He writes a 46-page letter in 1938 outlining his views on theology. So there's both a unity to all of this, Jeremy used the word Gesamtkunstwerk, and these many different avenues within it at the same time. And we have to, as readers, we have to kind of try to consume it all. It can be daunting, I must say.
How many years did it take your father to put this all together? The reason I ask this question is, I think one of the reasons it wasn't published so quick was just that Germany couldn't even think about that atrocious time and had to kind of come to grips of how to talk about it, how to see it. And do you think your father has had these changes of point of view, a depth that came up as he was writing, as he was experiencing it, and that was one of the reasons the writing changed and the rhythm changed, so he could get more of a Gesamte?
Partly, yes. I mean, the rhythm changed in the novels because that was the project, to write something different in every one, and that was uninfluenced by external events. It took him a long time to get the Theresienstadt book published. He had it finished in draft in 1948. It took till 1955 to get it out. That was an enormous struggle, and people like Hannah Arendt were called in to assist in the publication. Theodor Adorno then eventually found the money to pay for the publication. And then in 1950, so it came out in 55, and then the second edition came out in 1960. And a feature of the book, which I've mentioned that hasn't come up so far, is that it has a very significant apparatus. And you have to read all the chapters that Amy and Belinda have talked about in relation to the apparatus, which gives you the definitive proof, it provides the evidence for what is in the narrated text. And if you read the book with the apparatus, it explains how the final solution actually came about. It narrates the whole history of the final solution from the policies of the Nazis in the 1930s up to the decision to implement the final solution and the murder of the Jews. So, in actual fact, the book was very much noticed in 55 and 60 because it provided evidence. It was the first book which really provided not just documentary evidence, but argued evidence for the intention to exterminate the Jews. And as such, it was valued by the German Supreme Court. So that's a very different side of the book. The final book that Peter has introduced, Administered Man, is written very much in context of modern society. In America, you always mix up government and administration as if they were one and the same thing. And you talk about the incoming administration. And this book argues, no, that's absolutely wrong. People can be governed, things can be administered, and as soon as you start to muddle up the two, trouble appears. And he saw this mental confusion as rife throughout the West and the East. And that was a contemporary problem which he sought to address. And it still hasn't been taken on board by theoreticians.
And with one last question for Jeremy Adler. It's partly Hannah Arendt's name has been mentioned a couple times. As Jeremy said, she saw an early manuscript of the book in 48 or 49. She cites it in Origins of Totalitarianism, which appears in 1950. She worked to try and get Theresienstadt published. They weren't close, but they had some sort of a working relationship. They both talked about the cooperation of Jews with the German system. And so there was a lot that united them. And then after the Eichmann book came out, he was quite unhappy with the book. He published a long essay in German condemning the book, condemning it, I think is appropriate. So I was wondering if you could just talk a little bit about your understanding of his attitude towards Arendt's work on the Holocaust, both in 1950 and then again with the Eichmann work, if that is something. Yes. I know it's a big question.
It's a very big question. Obviously, he was very indebted to Hannah Arendt for her efforts for the Theresienstadt book, and I think that the Theresienstadt book stands there along with Arendt's work on totalitarianism as one of those big books to have come out of the war. Books written against violence. Books written to liberate the survivors. Books written to expiate the murder. So there are several books like that, but these are Karl Popper's philosophical books were also written in a similar spirit. The Open Society and Its Enemies. So there were a few books like that, really monumental in scope. And in that extent, to that extent, Adler and Arendt were had a joint project and could coexist quite well until the Eichmann trial and Eichmann and Jerusalem, which my father couldn't go along with, where Arendt was, in his view, misusing his own insights into the camp construction and the role of the camp leaders. And Arendt, in the first version of Eichmann in Jerusalem, she even calls Leo Bick, the Jewish rabbi, a Jewish Führer. She toned that down in the later version, but it incensed my father and many other people, like Shoah. And there was no meeting after that point. He did not attack her in English. He didn't think it was appropriate to join the fray in New York or anywhere outside his circle, but when the book was translated into German, then he thought it was within his ambit to attack it in a scholarly way. But he didn't want to partake in the glory of attacking Arendt on the international stage and just be seeking to combat her. That was not his game. But when it was a question of being truthful, as he saw it with the book, then he felt called up to do it.
Thank you very much. I want to thank again Jeremy Adler for coming, Peter Perkins.